leaving earth is prepare a place for you. And we can read about and how beautiful that's going to be. That is heaven. Every time something is on our heart or there's something that's weighing on us and we pray to God, our message is going through to that very throne room of God, and God is hearing all of those things. He knows what's on our hearts and what's in our minds, and every time we sing, we're worshiping a God, we're praising a God that is in heaven and on the throne of heaven. But for some reason, the thought of death and talking about death is still one that's very depressing, even in the church. I remember growing up, my parents would sing a song, and if this is a little embarrassing, I don't care. They would sing a song that was they made up out of this book, I'll Love You Forever. And if you've read the book, it's already sad enough as it is. But they made a tune to it, and they would sing it to us before we went to bed. And they stopped singing that when we were like 18 years old, you know. But they sang this song, and the words to that song were, I'll love you forever as long as we're living. Your babies, you'll be. And for some reason, I didn't like the ending of that song. I hated it. As long as we're living. And then I would start thinking about a time when my parents wouldn't be around anymore. And so I'd start, to cry and feel sad. And to the point that my parents would have to end that song by adding some more lyrics to it, by saying something along the lines of, the babies, you'll be, and as long as we're living, for many, 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 many more years, to make sure that we wouldn't cry. And even now, I grew up listening to my dad preach sermons. There was this one sermon that I heard him preach several times at gospel meetings, and he would end that sermon by saying, there's going to be one Sunday where I'm going to walk in, I'm going to preach my last sermon. I'm going to sing my last songs, and I'm going to worship together with the saints for the last time. And every time he would preach that, no matter how many times I heard it, it was just tears streaming down, even though I know, as a faithful gospel preacher, he's going to heaven. I'm going to see him again, but the thought of death is such a terrible thought because we're going to miss those that we love and miss those people that we care about. If you look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15, it is a chapter where Paul will talk about death quite a bit. But I want us to notice something, because as we've talked about throughout this entire letter, Paul is getting on to these Christians about several different things that they're struggling with and lots of different sinful issues. And really, we would talk about the Corinthian church, the church there at Corinth, as being somewhat dysfunctional. I mean, they had several different issues. And still, when Paul gets to the 15th chapter here, he talks about death, but mentioned along with this word death, is that word hope. And he'll talk about the hope that we have because of the resurrection of Christ. The hope that we have that's an assurance of as Christians. And there's almost really an excitement in his voice. In previous chapters we've read, and you can see almost the anger that he has and the frustrations that he's having with this church here. But when he gets to chapter 15, he can't help but read the excitement in his voice as he's talking about the future of every faithful Christian. And he's talking to a church that struggles in a lot of different terrible ways. There's a lot of people that struggle with guilt, even in the church. And Paul still talks to the church here and calls them brothers, and still tells them to hold on to that hope that we have, and that hope that we have because of Christ. So he'll mention hope along with this in verses 1 and 10. He'll talk about the people of hope. So he said, I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, and which you stand, by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believe in vain. So there's several different pulls that are coming from the world here that are trying to drag them away from that faith that they have. Several different doctrines that are coming in. They have an issue with idol worship. They have an issue with the sexual sins that they have there. They have a lot of different pulls that are pulling them away from that previous gospel. But he says, in which you stand, by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word that I preached to you. For I delivered to you as of first importance, but I also received that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures. So they will go on to have an issue with the resurrection. Is there a resurrection of the dead? Is it possible that someone can be raised from the dead? And so Paul will make a point. Yes, it is possible to be raised from the
bread, and if that were not the case, then we have no hope, because Jesus proclaimed to be raised from the dead. I want to focus a lot of our time this evening not really talking about this resurrection of Christ here, because we really don't have a lot of time to talk about several major ideas, but I'd like to encourage you all, maybe when you go home, or find some time this week to read through these sections talking about the resurrection of Christ and the resurrected body that we have, and it's very, very encouraging. Talking about that new body that we're going to have. Now, I know that I'm almost 24, I'm 24 in a few days here, and for some reason, I still have foot pain, knee pain, and back pain, and it's still very encouraging for me to go through this session and read about those new bodies that we're going to have, a time when there's going to be no pain and no aches, and not everything is going to pop when you wake up in the morning. It's very encouraging. So I'd like to go ahead and encourage all of us to read through that this week, and maybe even tonight if you have the time. But we're going to spend the rest of this lesson looking at verses 50 to 58, that's 50 to the last of this chapter. And he's going to talk about the power of hope that we have, and what that hope should be for us, the mindset that we should have. And it's really, it's gotten me on to the Christians here that up to this point, at this time, they're reading through this letter all at one time. And so they're getting a lot of information. Have you ever been in a conversation with somebody and it starts getting down to maybe all the things that you're doing wrong, you know, and it's about all the problems that you have, the things that you need to change. It's not a very comfortable conversation to be in. Well, Paul is going through several different major issues that the churches are struggling with, and it's a lot of information. And so I've always looked at this chapter as Paul is now getting to the point where he's telling them all the things they need to work on, but then he's still giving them that hope. You have this salvation. You know the truth. You know what Christ did for you, so let me just remind you after telling you all those things you need to work on. So he doesn't leave them without hope, and that's a really good reminder for us Christians too. Never have to talk to a brother or a sister about something that maybe they're doing wrong, something they need to work on. Don't end on negative. Paul is getting to this point after telling them those hard things, and then he gives them really this shot in the arm of encouragement. But look, I know you have all of these major issues that you need to work on, but we have this hope, and we have this eternal home that we're going with. You're faithful, and if you remain steadfast in this gospel that you have, then you have all of this reason to hope and to have this assurance and this steadfastness. I want to read through this section because it's very powerful, starting in verse 50. He says, I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on the immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on the immortality, this shall come to pass, the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. I don't even have to go through and dissect this section and say, okay, here's what this means for us. It is very straightforward. He's talking about the power of Christ and what Christ has done in the first place for us, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. Sometimes the work of the church, I will tell you, is very fun. I love it. I like going and visiting and talking with people. I like preparing lessons. There's a lot about it that I do like, but sometimes the work of a Christian, and I'm not just talking a minister, I'm talking about the work of the church as a whole, can be uncomfortable. And sometimes it can be a little bit difficult when it comes to things like evangelism. That's the easiest one to pick on, right? Starting up those conversations with people, they can be a little bit awkward and maybe a little bit uncomfortable. And sometimes we see it, we say, you know, what's the point? People don't really like going to church much anymore. Or, you know, these people wouldn't be very interested in coming to a church like this. It seems, you know, traditional, or there's no instruments, or whatever. whatever. We come up with all these reasons, all of these roadblocks that we put in our way and say, nobody is going to be interested in this. And so it becomes exactly how Paul describes it here, a weight. It's a burden. It's a difficulty. And maybe it's not that. Maybe it's a struggle with sin. And this is something that you've been dealing with for a long time. It could be very typical among Christians that have become Christians after living most of their life away from the Lord or in sin. And changing that lifestyle. When you come up out of the water and you've made that commitment to Christ to be a new man, a different person, a new creature, Paul describes it, rejecting that animalistic side of humanity and embracing that holy side, being separate and apart from it. About it as being a labor. When you come out of the water as a Christian, you are rejecting the world. It's a work. And sometimes it can be a burden. And so Paul is reminding them, and it's very appropriate after telling them, you have all of these temptations. You have all of these sins that you're battling. You have all of these issues that you've got to work out because it's causing so much division in the church. You've got to quit, quit, quit. And then we get to 15. Knowing that in the Lord, that labor, all of those difficult things that I've been talking to you about and asking you to change for your own good, for the sake of your soul, that labor is not in vain. Church, the work of the church is not in vain. The work of God's church is not in vain. Everything that we do, we spend a lot of time painting, standing, and doing things like that in the end, and that's great. But if we can use that for the good of the church here at Forest, we can use that as a tool, that labor is not going to be in vain. If we can choose and make that conscious decision that when we go out for the rest of this week, starting tomorrow, going all the way to next Sunday, if we can choose to talk to our coworkers, talk to our neighbors, talk to our friends, even though it might be a little bit uncomfortable, even if they reject you, even if they make you feel a little bit uncomfortable, and that friendship is never the same afterwards, even if that labor is not. Paul is telling them some very difficult things. We have to realize that though he's talking to the Corinthian church, he has to be talking to us as well. He also talks about how you can know that you have salvation in the Lord. And that's really that last section there. Well, but he talks about going right back up so we can pull out some of the major points that he's trying to make here, most of them being about that hope that we have. In verse 51, he says, "Behold, I tell you a mystery." I looked into this word mystery because, obviously, so it says, "Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep." So this is a mystery that is now uncovered. Things that those in the Old Testament under the Old Law really wanted to know. But these mysteries, the things he's talking about here, are really the hidden counsels of God. This is what is in the mind of God. This is the plan that God has. And Paul unravels that for us in this chapter. It is an incredible chapter. "Behold, I tell you a mystery." And what is that mystery about? When Christ comes, notice all the things that are going to go into that. We're going to be changed. In that moment, we're going to be changed. In the twinkling of an eye, that word twinkling there in that phrase, the twinkling of the eye, in the Greek means the very smallest moment that you can imagine. That's very cool, and that's very scary, depending on where you're at in the spirit. Because if you think about it, they say that a person blinks in 1/30th of a second. I don't know exactly what that translates over into, but here's what I do. In the blink of an eye, you don't have enough time to repent, to confess, to be baptized. You don't have enough time to change your life around in the blink of an eye. You don't have enough time in that moment to make any last change. For some reason, I always thought about this when I was growing up, in the time that it takes for the clouds to roll back like a scroll, and while the trumpet is blasting, I'm going to go run and grab somebody and apologize for something that I did, or try and change something and turn around at the last minute, and right before God comes back, right as he's coming down on that cloud, then I'll turn around, I'll change things, and then I'll hop on that cloud and I'll go to heaven and it'll be all good. We talked about it being the twinkling of an eye. Where's the comfort? Because if you're sitting there, it's very tempting to start kind of fishing in the pool of things that are kind of scary. When it comes to death, and you think about maybe those people that you love and that you can't wait to see, those that have gone on to see, all that can change. If they were faithful and they went another lesson there for us is to make sure that we are listening and make sure that we're holding fast. Here's the mystery of God. We're not going to sleep. We're going to be changed. The twinkling of an eye at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised, imperishable, and we will be changed. Twice that mentioned. The trumpet will sound. This is not Louis Armstrong. I mean, this is not like this trumpet that's only going to be heard by the people that are in the immediate area or the immediate vicinity. This is a trumpet that Paul is talking to these people and talking to us today. This is a trumpet that the entire world is going to hear. That means everyone and every doubt, every atheist, every person that's ever put off salvation or come into Christ or changed, every single person in a twinkling of an eye, any day, any moment, is going to realize that there is a God. And that God is all powerful. But they won't have enough time. Verse 53 says, "It is the perishable body." We know that. Must put on the imperishable, and the mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on the immortality, then shall come to pass this saying that is written: death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? He goes on to talk about what that sting of death is, and it's that sin. But the one that took on that force is Jesus. Jesus is the one that made all of this possible. It was a hot summer day, and there was a kid riding in the car. He was on the way to school, and there's this bee that was flying around in the car, and the kid starts to scream because he has a phobia of bees, as does every smart person. I've been stung several times by bees and wasps. Everything that stings, it seems I've been on the wrong end of that every time in my life. But the kid screams, and the grandpa then calmly says, "You don't have to worry about it." And he holds up his hand, and his hand is the stinger of the bee. He says, "You don't have to worry about it because the stinger is in my hand." Jesus did that for us. When Jesus went to the cross, when he made that ultimate sacrifice, he took the sting for us. We don't have to dread death. We don't have to worry about that anymore because Jesus gave us a way out. He took the sting of death and gave us a way. Christianity is difficult. There are things about it that is difficult, but there is so much hope in Christianity. A lot of hope that the world doesn't even know about. A lot of hope that maybe our friends and family don't fully understand what it is. He talks about the hope that we have, and he mentions it, and I made all of them start with S, starting in verse 58 here, so if you want to write these down on the side of your Bible to help you remember a little bit better, feel free to do so. Says that hope makes you stable by using that word steadfast there. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast. You can be stable. If you have that hope, then be steadfast. Stay there. Be steadfast in that hope, knowing that what you have, the gospel that was preached, the decision that you made to be baptized, to come up and to walk in newness of life, know that that's right. Stay there. Because that was the problem that the Corinthian church, they were having. Paul came, preached to them, then left. And then after he left, they started kind of falling apart and going into all of these different doctrines and making very terrible decisions. So Paul comes back and says, "Hey, you have this. You have the gospel. You know the truth. You know the message of Jesus. Stay there." It is very easy for us as Christians, at least sometimes, an argument that sounds actually pretty good. And maybe it's very tempting for us to give into these arguments, not look into them, and have them lead us away just a little bit. That's how it happens. You know, why can't we have, you know, women on the Lord's Day? Why can't we have intimacy? Why can't we have this or that? Paul reminds us, look, you know what you need. You have it all in one. Stay there and be steadfast. Also, hope can make you stubborn. This is the bullheadedness that's actually really good to have. One of the few areas in life that is good to be absolutely stubborn in is your Christianity and your faith. Be stubborn about it. He says, be steadfast and be immovable. Don't let anyone come in and steal your salvation. I don't know what your most prized possession is. I know what mine is. It is my motorcycle. That is my most prized possession that I have. I want it. I want to keep it, and I'm very stubborn about that. But there are some things that I would give that up. I don't love it so much that I would do anything to keep it. But my salvation, my faith, that is one thing that I do not lose. Because as Paul builds up here and talks about this hope that we have and that future home that we have and the relationship that we have with Christ, that has to be the most important thing in our life. That has to be more important than our job and our career. That has to be the most important thing to us. So he's going to be immovable. Be very stubborn about your faith. Don't let anyone take it away from you. Don't let anyone lead you astray. That's very difficult to apply to some people. That's very difficult to apply if maybe your spouse has come to you today, or someone in your family, or a good friend. And for the church here, it was individuals within the church that were causing these divisions. And it was their entire culture at the time. They were in the middle of sin sick. And he's trying to make some relations to where we're at here outside of country. But they had a lot of things pledging the church there. And Paul is trying to remind them, I know there are a lot of things that are attacking you, including people inside of your church. But don't let them take your salvation. Don't let them take your hope. Is always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing. Always abounding, be strong. Hope makes you stable, makes you stubborn, and makes you strong. Abounding in that hope. And my favorite part of this entire chapter is the last ending phrase here. The work of the Lord, knowing that in you. You can know that you have salvation. There's a lot of, especially younger people, that don't believe that you can absolutely know if you're saved. And some people will go as far to say, you know, how can you be so bold? Or how can you be so confident to think that you know the very mind of God and to know that you're saved? Well, thankfully, it's not up to me. And thankfully, it's not up to anybody in this room. God's already told us you can know. You can know that you're saved, and that's good enough for you. If the creator of this entire universe and of my soul can look down and say, if you do this, if you live faithfully, if you hold fast, and if you're steadfast in the truth and the hope that you have, then you can know that you're saved. Once you know that you're saved, hold on to that hope. If you don't know that, if you're not a part of the family, the body of Christ, then why not? Why not listen to Paul here instead of sin and realize that that is the most important thing that you will ever have? Or maybe you did have that and you lost it. Tonight you can change that as well. You can walk out those back doors with a renewed relationship with Christ. You can be a part of the body of God that is going home. Anyone in your family, if they're faithful Christians or all those faithful brothers and sisters that have gone on before, death doesn't have to be a scary thing. It doesn't have to be a depressing time. Because if you have that hope, it can be very, very exciting. And don't get me wrong, I do want to clarify here that there are people that I know that when it is their time, I'm going to miss a lot. But it gets a whole lot easier knowing that I'll be able to see them at any point. I may not even get to the end of it. I may not even get to the standard. Body